Hi, namaste,
and thank you for tuning into this video. Today the theme is wealth, abundance, and prosperity, having exactly what we need in order to do what we're called to do, what we feel, the desire, the yearning, or the pull to do in life. A long, long time ago, back in the days before I was drawn to Hinduism, I watched a video by a being called Bashar here on YouTube, and he defined abundance as the ability to do what you need to do when you need to do it. At the time that I first heard that, this would have been back in like 2008, 2009, it was truly mind-blowing. Because up till then, I always thought of abundance as meaning cash, assets, property, you know, value of possessions, having something that you can barter or trade to get something else. But I was thinking of it within the terms or within the confinement of a monetary system or a currency-based system. It was only by listening to Bashar's very unique perspective of abundance that I had a shift and realized if somebody really deeply desires to go to Hawaii, having the money for the plane ticket, the money to stay at a resort, you know, the money to get their passport, whatever else they might need, that is not more valuable than winning a trip and having an all-expense-paid trip, or having a friend invite them along who happens to have a place there instead of staying in a resort. Suddenly I was thinking of abundance not in terms of I need this in order to get that, but within the terms of if I want that, using all the resources of existence to get it instead of thinking it can only come in one way. So sorry if I'm babbling, this is kind of a lofty concept to try to describe. But it became even more apparent to me, or even more clear, when later my guru, Paramahamsa Nityananda, described abundance and wealth as being a fluidity, a constant movement, not something that's set and stagnant. He described that a lot of people think wealth is the bank balance, how many zeros follow that one on the screen, or how much, you know, of an asset we have financially. But he, very similarly to Bashar, described that according to the ancient Hindu scriptures, abundance is the ability to manifest and to keep the flow, to keep that circulation active. He said the current that keeps the currency in motion gives the value to the currency. For example, if everybody decided at the exact same time to stop spending money, that money means nothing to them, the value of that dollar or that euro or that rupee would immediately disappear. It's only when it keeps circulating, when we decide, yes, I'll trade you this for that, yes, I'll give you this money for that house or for that ring or for that car, that the money has value. He described that when you have a lot, hoarding it, stashing it away, keeping it, and thinking that you need to save it, that actually reduces the value. When you keep it circulating, it continues to grow and prosper. That's the key to abundance. Beyond that, generosity makes abundance flower. The Hindu goddess Lakshmi is the goddess of wealth. She's also the goddess of generosity, the goddess of keeping a happy, vital, vibrant home, a vital, vibrant society. You can see her on this necklace that I'm wearing, this choker. She's seated within a lotus. There are elephants who represent prosperity on either side of her. And most importantly, as I've mentioned in other videos before, while one of her hands is blessing in the typical mudra, or the typical position of benediction, the other hand is open and golden coins are just flowing from it. Swamiji Nityananda, he described, if ever she tried to close her fist and hold on to those coins of hers, the entire flow of wealth would come to an ending. But because she keeps her hand constantly open, showering on everything and everyone, existence continues to replenish her stock. It's like if you dam up a river. The moment that river is dammed, the current stops flowing. Eventually, the riverbed is going to dry up. It's going to pool on one side. The balance will be lost. But if the river is left undammed, that water will continue to flow and eventually reach the sea. The same thing with our wealth. First and foremost, if we want to be wealthy and we want to be abundant, dropping the fear of poverty, letting go of the idea that you need a certain amount in order to achieve a certain goal. Now, I'm not saying don't be practical and don't save what you need to and don't have resources for things like rent or food or clothing or whatever you need to spend your money on, but don't hold the money thinking you're going to lose it, you're going to be without. The first cognition in order to be abundant and manifest abundance and be successful is to remember Lakshmi and that flow that's coming from her. I'll give the example of my little Etsy shop. I reopened my shop when I came back from India, when I decided to come back into the world instead of living as a monastic Hindu. One of the first things I did was reopen my Etsy shop, and I did it with whatever pieces of jewelry and whatever stones I had that I had had before I took Kavi, which is the saffron cloth of a renunciant. I remade those into new pieces and put them into my shop. That means even though I had already gotten rid of everything, given everything away, I reopened it with whatever I had. That's what it means when Bashar says the ability to do what you need to do when you need to do it. Instead of thinking, oh man, I need money to buy stock, I need money for beads, I need money for supplies, what do I do, what do I do, I have nothing. What some people might do is then get a job thinking it's a safe option. They'll go for something that they feel is a socially approved or a conventional way to get point B from point A. But if we drop this idea that there's only one way to manifest, we will suddenly see resources all around us that we hadn't previously considered. Another example of this, I knew artists when I was going to the art school Emily Carr in Vancouver, who would make their art out of mixed media and found objects. They were like the freegans of the art world. Instead of going to an art supply shop, like this really expensive place called Opus that was across from our school, they would go into recycling bins and find paper and just pulverize it with water and put it into a big screen and make their own rag paper. They would make their art supplies out of whatever found objects they can. And their art would have so much character to it, it would almost be even better than those who just paid 20 bucks for a sheet of paper because they thought that that big expensive thing was needed to convey their message. That ability to do what we need to do when we need to do it, it's very intrinsically related to our survival need. When we want something, we can either be driven by the greed to get it or repelled by the fear of not having it. But that fear-driven and that greed-driven will never lead us to total, complete satisfaction. They'll either make us feel deficient and like the object or the experience is going to fulfill that void, or they'll make us feel like we're antagonistic towards others, like competitive, like we have to put others down in order to have what we want. In Hinduism, Lakshmi, that goddess of wealth, she represents the higher, elevated perspective. It's not to say that nobody should enjoy luxury. It's to say that the two options are not poverty or suppressing others. There's that third path, that third option, which is satya, being neither greed-driven nor fear-driven, but creativity-driven. In Hinduism, actually, there are three primary goddesses that we connect with, and of course, many expressions and emanations of all of them. But the three main goddesses includes Saraswati, who's the goddess of creativity, art, intelligence, wisdom. Lakshmi, the goddess of wealth, generosity, abundance. And Durga, the goddess of devotion and power. The three are not separate. They're all different expressions of the same divine feminine quality. A lot of people will think if we're creative, we can never be wealthy because we're more driven by our passion to express, or the creative instinct, that drive to convey an idea, an emotion, or beauty. And if somebody is money-driven, they'll go into a dry, dull job in finances, and they'll have a creativity-less, you know, kind of ascetic, value-driven life. The beauty here is to realize that Lakshmi is like another face of Saraswati. Saraswati is another face of Lakshmi. They're not opponents. They come together. In fact, in another discourse about wealth, Paramahamsa Nityananda described the ability to generate abundance through your creative effort is the sign, it's like the benchmark, that your creativity is truly flowing. Because when we express, when we create, when we put something out there, naturally it's going to attract a return. Continuing with that flow will ensure that we always have whatever we need. So again, to give my own little shop as the example, and I'm saying you can replicate this in any way you choose, but once I got it reopened with whatever little bit I had, as those pieces sold, I started ordering more gems. I went to the Calgary Rock and Gem Show. I started contacting people who had rare stones and deity jewelry and started putting it together. The more we use that creativity, the more we accumulate to express it, the more we share that gift with others, whether that means by selling our work or making tutorial videos or putting up art exhibits or maybe starting an Instagram account and sharing the inspiration, when we take what we find as our passion and we put it out there, naturally existence will replenish us so that we can keep doing more and more of what it is we're passionate about. So if you're watching this video and you're interested in manifesting wealth and being creative and having fulfillment for doing what you love, there's more to it than just wearing a gemstone. Of course, citrine is the stone of wealth. When we wear it, it acts as a talisman for us to manifest and generate the abundance we need. But it comes down to more than just wearing that stone or wearing a symbol of Lakshmi. It also comes down to making the decision to allow your creative flow to generate that wealth and to turn into the flow of abundance. Instead of stifling yourself and thinking, if I had that, then I would do this, deciding, okay, I'm going to do this. Typically, to do this, I'd think I need that, but let me start with what I have now. Building your abundance from the ground up is definitely a key to success. Deciding that what you want to do creatively has value. You value it, otherwise you wouldn't love doing it. So naturally, others will also find that value and will share it. I remember when I was young, when I was like 12 or 13, I was babysitting my little cousins once. And back then I loved to doodle. I could draw abstract designs for hours and hours and hours. And these two little boys were more into playing with their Tonka trucks and, you know, playing Power Rangers and running around outside. Totally different energy from what I was into. And so they were running around, they were playing, and I was sitting down with my sketchbook, just kind of drawing and watching them, making sure they were okay. And after a while, I decided to invite them over and I asked, would you both like to learn how to draw like this too? Would you like to do some abstract designs? Well, my grandma still talks about this to this day. They sat down with me and we drew for more than 2 hours. They didn't say a word. You know what little kids are like when they're concentrating, their tongues are out and they're just drawing like they're absorbed in that paper. Well, I remember they loved to draw so much. And about a week later, my auntie called me and she said that her younger boy had gone to school drawing little drawings like that. And the other kids started buying his drawings with their lunch money. So he started his own little business selling art. And I think he was in grade 1 or grade 2 at the time. When we do what we love, when we express our creativity, that itself will manifest that wealth. It'll draw wealth to us. Now, a lot of people ask, what if they try but the money doesn't come? All that that means is that the effort is being held back a little bit and it's not being prolonged. Continue, continue, continue. Do what you love. If, and it's a big if you need to do something else on the side to support yourself, go ahead and do that. But the moment you decide you want to manifest and generate abundance for yourself, be your own boss, be your own source of income and affluence and prosperity so that your life is creativity driven, not just money driven, the best time to start is immediately. And the best thing that you can do is examine what you love doing and find a way to creatively do it. Whether that means writing or editing other people's work. My mom loves taking on projects as a proofreader because English and the language arts are her passion. whatever it might be, finding something you love to do and doing it and connecting with Lakshmi Devi and trusting that she will guide you to find a way to do it in a way that manifests what you need, it'll keep you elevated, and then you'll have the true wealth Bashar described, the ability to do what you need to do when you need to do it. You'll have the valuable currency, as Swamiji described it, the current that keeps the currency in the current, keeps the flow going, is going to just swoop you away, carry you with that tide, and what starts as a little stream will turn into a river and will lead into that ocean. You will have everything that you need and much, much more. Now, of course, I do actually work with stones. I work with crystals. That's why I made this choker with lots of pieces of citrine. I have a few talismans like that, from simple little citrine pendants that are under $20, and bracelets like this men's bracelet with an ombre citrine pattern. See all those pretty stones in the center? They're all different colors of citrine.